Welcome, everyone. Another episode of Back and Forth with Becker and Orr. Kevin and I are ready to go. We're going to have lots of fun today. And our main topic, does this end badly? We've seen lots of market froth, pockets of exuberance, these mini bubbles. Does it end badly? We'll get into that today. Plus all the other topics. You can see them at the bottom of the screen here. So you want to stay tuned. Lots of fun.
Yeah, it's another one of our main videos that we want to put out there. You can find all of them at our website at beckerorr.com or on our YouTube channel or Facebook page. Please subscribe to those because lots of important information that you're going to miss otherwise. That being said, Clint, why don't you lead us into how things end badly?
Absolutely. And this is a key topic here. I've been asked it a couple of times. And I'm using Tesla as an example. You can see it on the screen. We've seen a couple of stocks, a couple of areas that have just shot to the moon throughout 2020, early 2021. And I think most people think, oh, that's got to burst. That bubble's got to burst. And we've got to see a complete crash. So I threw you the question there, Kevin. Does this end badly?
Well, that's the big question. It's hard to call. I mean, I would say no, based on the way things have gone. Let's remember, we've come right through a pandemic here. So a lot of people have been at home. There's been a lot of unemployed and there's been stimulus checks coming out. So what have people done with it? 90% of the population want to spend it. Can't go to Vegas to bet. Let me bet here. So I'm going into the market and I'm buying a whole bunch of things. Now, if we see the economy slowly start to open, we could easily see that this starts to taper off. So as opposed to the big, oh, it's a bubble, it's going to crash. Maybe it just fizzles out. That may be sort of the area that I'm taking a look at. Not to say that that's definitely going to happen, but it's a possibility. What can you say on this?
Yeah, I think that's a narrative that's not getting as much attention. It could just fizzle out. It doesn't have to just be a bang and a bust and then suddenly there's a big crash and all these little mini bubbles. It could just be people get back to work. They're not trading as frequently. They have other things to keep their attention. Vegas opens back up and suddenly we get back to something semblance of normal and you don't get all the frothy trading you had before and these stocks kind of fizzle out. That is a real possibility. Exactly. Now, who knows? Maybe it will crash. I'm leaning towards it fizzles out more than it hits a big crash. What do you say?
Yeah, I agree with that completely. And again, I mean, let's take a look at it. A lot of this has been very tech oriented to begin with. So you've had a lot of the froth in there as opposed to any of the other areas that have been around. And again, if we take a look in reality, this time when they say, oh, is it different this time? Yes, it probably is a little different this time only because back, let's say 2000, when you had the stock market correction and the tech bubble burst, most of those companies didn't make any money. Nowadays, you've got Google, you've got Microsoft, you got Apple, you got Facebook. These are all Fortune 500 companies. They make money. So this time it is slightly different. Now, that being said, though, there are options that we can't see.
Yeah, that was a perfect lead in there, Kevin. What's on the screen now is the fact we've seen publicly listed companies, the number of publicly listed companies with no revenue, zero revenue companies valued at over $1 billion. So that's obviously quite speculative. They don't make any money, no revenue. They got a billion-dollar valuation. The number of those companies now exceeds what we had back in 2000. So now it's at a record level. So that's got to say people are willing to take some risk. That's got to be a sign of frothiness right there.
Yeah, we definitely in the wrong business. We need to find a billion-dollar idea where we don't have to make any money and we can show people exactly how to buy in. So somehow we'll come up with that. But yeah, you're right. I mean, it's gotten to the point now where I think people, anything that comes out, they want to take a buy on. You get that sort of a casino atmosphere going on. And as long as you're in the right areas, you're in tech, you might be in mining. If you're a lead going forward, I think people are just buying in regardless of whether it is. They're looking for what's going to go down in the future. That's sort of the avenue I'm seeing as to why we're getting this. But as you see, just like you've said there, I mean, in the last 20 years, we've really had nothing compared to what we've got now. Do you see this continuing?
I think the supply is going to be there. Leave it to Wall Street to drown something in supply. If people are buying it up, they'll find 17 more products to sell you in that vein. And that's what's happening here is they just keep doing more and more companies to market through whatever means they can, IPO, SPAC, you name it, they're going to throw them out there. I think that'll continue until they stop getting the appetite, until they stop getting the big gains, until they stop getting all the money in the door. Then that'll get drowned in supply and they'll move on to the next thing. So who knows how long it'll continue. To me, it feels like we're in the seventh inning there and there could be two more innings before it's done. But maybe there's a very long seventh inning stretch. I don't know.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, I think it'll all depend on how fast the economy starts to reopen. I mean, over the last few weeks, we've started to see that sort of tech bubble, as they call it, start to move down a little bit. I think it's more of a normal correction. But again, once you start seeing that, once the economy start opening, then yeah, people start to say, well, there's other things to do nowadays. Maybe we won't see that going forward. That being said, though, I mean, are interest rates having a big effect on any of this as well?
I think rates are going to play into that a little bit. Keep in mind, rates were at historic lows. A year ago when the crash hit the pandemic, they pulled rates down to rock bottom levels. There really was nothing to do with cash. You were getting nothing in cash, nothing in your bonds. You had no other alternative. If you wanted to make a return, you had to take a little bit of risk. So I think you could see a small component of that as rates start to come up and people can start to get something for their risk-free money. You may have a little less speculation, but by and large, I don't think it'll have that big of a difference. You can see on the chart there, see on the screen, rates have come up. They've more than doubled from where they were this time last year, but they're still at the low end of a 10-year trading range. Even with the doubling, they're still kind of the lowest range we've seen in the last decade. So you can't say they're actually going to get a whole lot of traction when they're still that low.
No, it's always funny when you say, oh, it's doubled and it's still at the low range of the end or low end of the range. And yeah, I mean, we're talking about what, a 10-year at 1.5 right now? It's still significantly lower than what anybody's going to really need to survive if you get inflation going on and the economy opens to where it is. I have no doubt that it'll play a factor going forward. I mean, if you start to see things open up a little bit more robust, I mean, I know that at least in North America, the governments want to keep it sort of around that 2% at the most on the inflation side of things. So there is the possibility that you start to see rates go up a little bit. But I don't think it's going to have a huge effect going forward. I still believe in what they've said that, you know, they're sort of looking at 2022, 2023 range before they start looking at interest rates. And again, with all the debt that we started to see going on for governments, how fast can you increase that before you have to worry about what their debt payments are each and every month going forward every year? So that's something to consider.
I think part of this is also the inflation story. I think part of this is the bond market saying, hey, we're going to get revved up here. The economy is going to go faster and grow stronger than you think. And that's going to lead to higher inflation. So rates are going to have to go up. And part of that story, though, is I think the Federal Reserve, the big central banks, Bank of Canada and around the world, they may have to step in. Do you think they'd start to step in to control the longer dated rates as well? Because we know they control the short end of the curve. They don't often control the long end of the curve. Do you think if it gets carried away, they would step in, Kevin?
Yeah, I think that they may have to do something along those lines. It depends on how far out of whack things go. I mean, if it's sort of that normal yield curve that we see, I don't think it's going to be as big a deal. But I think if you start to see some sort of a big spike coming at the long end, the government's going to have to step in and do something along the lines of Fed purchases or things along those lines to make sure that they control it. Last thing you want to do is have too much of a sector rotation one way or the other based on where it's going. Let's remember, I've heard economists this year say that this may be the first year in decades where the U.S. actually outperforms China for what they can actually do for growth over the course of the year, just because we've been shut down for so long and you're starting to see that anticipation of everybody going out. But that's definitely something that we have to watch. And I think they've got a good handle on it at the moment.
Yeah, I think a level there, and this is just me speculating, is rates maybe, and we're looking at the 10-year rate here, perhaps it can climb as high as 2, maybe. Who knows? Mm-hmm. But if it gets beyond that, I think you'll see the central bank start to step in to kind of keep that under wraps. I can't see it going to 2.5, 3 or anywhere in that neighborhood, at least not in the short term. I think you probably see 2 as an unofficial ceiling there before the Federal Reserve steps in. But let's shift gears here a little bit. Lots on the financial side. I know you're a big movie buff. Eventually we'll reopen here, Kevin. Are you going back to the theaters? You think there's going to be lots of people joining you?
I want to go back now. I'm very upset that I can't. I mean, I'm a huge fan of watching a movie at the theater. There's one thing to watch it on a big screen at home or anything else, but it's the whole experience. Popcorn, drinks. I know I pay vastly far too much money to do that, but being there in the seat and seeing is what I really like to do. And I'm really upset that I can't go back at the moment. But I don't know that things are going to stay that way. I mean, nowadays you've got Amazon Prime. There's the new Paramount Plus, HBO Max, Disney, Netflix. More and more people are finding that, you know, if you can watch movies at home, why do I want to go to the theater? And not only that, but most of these companies now are even getting to the point where they're releasing in the theater the same day they're releasing on their online platform. So I think that's going to be a problem. What's your view? I know you like to watch things yourself.
Yeah, my wife and I, we enjoy it. Now, we live in Beaujolais, so we don't have a whole lot of movie theaters to attend. It's a big outing for us to go to the city to go see a theater. So we do quite a bit from home, and we have pretty much every streaming platform. We've got the Amazon, the Disney Plus, the Netflix, Crave. We have all of them now. And I think the key here is they're in the experimentation phase, right? They're in the trial phase. They're seeing if they can release the movies at the same time as they do in theater, and they're trying to see the traction they get with that model. And when things open back up, we've already seen the big companies say, all right, we're going to have our blockbusters. We're going to put them in theater. But we want to wait until all the theaters are open so we can get more bang for our buck. So I think the business model is going to change. I don't know to what extent, though. And I think the companies are just going to wait to see what the bottom line is, right? If they can make money with movies and theaters, they'll do that. If not, they'll probably lean more heavily into the streaming model. Clearly, they're going to follow the bottom line.
Yeah, and I mean, with the business model changing, I guess the biggest question that I'd ask you, and I find that this is probably the way they're going to go, I think we'll see more of what, at least in this city, would be a landmark scenario, as opposed to what you've got with the sort of the Cineplex scenario, where it's the big comfy seats, as opposed to the 300 seat state or movie theaters. You're going down to 80 seats, but it's a comfort scenario. So we'll give you the whole plush experience, as opposed to, okay, sit there with everybody else. What do you think?
Yeah. More the VIP model, right? More the VIP model, where you get a nice experience, you get a comfy chair, maybe you have a drink with you, maybe it's a licensed venue, so it's more of a night out, as opposed to just cramming as many people as you can into the theater. So you're probably right. You're probably going to get more of that experience, as opposed to just the movie itself.
Yeah. So leading into our question, I had somebody ask me the other day is, now that we've got the 1.9 stimulus that'll probably pass in the House tomorrow, is this the last stimulus package, or are we going to get more?
I think this will be the last pandemic stimulus package. They could do more. Biden's already talking about doing an infrastructure plan, which technically is stimulus. If they're spending money, that's considered stimulus. But I think it'll be the last time they do any kind of stimulus under the guise of pandemic relief. Like, think about it. They've already done over $5 trillion in the U.S., big money in Canada. Like, these are record levels. I can't see them having to throw any more under that pandemic relief banner in order to get this done. I think this will be the last one. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I mean, I think it's to the point now where unless you have a vaccine that is not enough to go against what the variants that are coming out there is, or, you know, Texas and Mississippi are now sort of 100% open. I mean, if everybody else does that tomorrow, maybe you get a sort of a run on a third wave that it's going to go on. But yeah, I can't see it going any further. I mean, there's so much stimulus coming down the road that, you know, sooner or later you have to pull it back, because you've got to pay for it eventually. And if you keep going and going and going, it's just not going to work out. So yeah, I'm in agreement with you on that one. I think that this may be the last stimulus package we see.
Yeah, the last one under the pandemic banner, right? They'll find other ways to, other priorities, right? They'll probably do infrastructure, maybe something on the green initiative. There'll be other money spent. I'm confident of that. It just might not be specific for the pandemic relief. Well, I think we've covered all the topics there, Kevin. Any parting words for the folks?
No, I think that's it. We've done what we wanted to do today, give you sort of that froth, give you sort of the billion-dollar companies, get back to the movie scenario, which hopefully I can get to one of these days. But and we've answered the fiscal stimulus package best we can. Other than that, like I say, we want to make sure that you get to our website, beckerorr.com, and our YouTube channel or anything else, and we're always here to talk. You get the closing words, Clint. What do you have to say?
Absolutely. You can see in the bottom of the screen there, chatwithclintonandkevin.com. That's part of our website. Feel free to visit it. If you have questions, fill out the form. We're happy to hear from you. With that, we'll say everyone stay safe, take care. We'll be back again next week.